First of all, everybody, I'm going to be speaking from 1 Samuel chapter 5. We're going to start at verse 1. 1 Samuel chapter 5. 1 Samuel chapter 5. And the Bible says, and the Philistines took the ark of God and brought it from Ebenezer unto Ashdod. And when the Philistines took the ark of God, they brought it unto the house of Dagon and set it by Dagon. And when day of Ashdod arose early on the morrow, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face to the earth before the ark of the Lord. And they took Dagon and set him in his place again. And when they rose early on the morrow morning, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face to the ground before the ark of the Lord. And the head of Dagon and both the palms of his hands were cut off upon the threshold. Only the stump of Dagon was left to him. Therefore, neither the priest of Dagon nor any that came into Dagon's house tread upon the threshold of Dagon and Ashdod unto this day. But the hand of the Lord was heavy upon them of Ashdod, and he destroyed them and smote them with hemorrhoids, even Ashdod and the coast thereof. And when the men of Ashdod saw that it was so, they said, the ark of the Lord God of Israel shall not abide with us, for his hand is sore upon us and upon Dagon, our God. I want to take my topic from verse 4 of 1 Samuel chapter 5. The very last sentence, it says, only the stump of Dagon was left to him. I'm going to take my title from that portion of verse 4. I'm just going to give you a statement. Stop settling for stumps. Stop settling for stump. The Bible tells us that in the previous verse, in 1 Samuel chapter 4, that Eli, he was the high priest, and he was also the prophet of God. Eli was the pastor of the children of Israel. And he had two sons. Eli had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas. And they were preachers under their father. But Eli's two sons, they were having a time with the young ladies in the church. They were fleecing God's sheep. But Eli, he didn't want to confront his sons. He was hoping they would stop on their own, and when reports would come to him about what his two boys was doing. I don't know if he ever confronted them about it. But whatever he did, it wasn't enough because it didn't stop, and they were still ministers. Let this be a warning to you, and I'm going to take a little time to talk to my pastors today. It is not right. It is not right. When Sister B, when she sins, or Brother C, when he sins, they have to sit down. And they're silenced. But when your kids sin, they can still be up there leading praise service and stuff. Oh, we can't have a double standard now. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. And this is why, ladies and gentlemen, that I've learned that when somebody in the church, when they sin, it's incumbent upon us to deal with it immediately. And if that person ask for forgiveness. And we give them a time to make sure that they're truly sincere about not doing and repeating what they've done. Then I don't see why that person cannot be restored. The Bible said we're supposed to restore them with love. But many times I've seen people, when they mess up in the church and it gets out, the church folks treat them so bad they wind up leaving because the folks don't want to forgive. But then if you go back to the very ones who don't want to forgive somebody and look into their closet, their closet is not as clean as they project themselves to be. But Eli's two sons, they did not repent. In fact, they kept on going. And I don't know whether Eli was hoping that it would go away. Amen. But as the pastor of that church, God held him responsible. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, he tried to ignore it. He tried to act like it wasn't going on. And everything was going good. But how many know the devil can sense when there is a chink in your armor? The devil can sense when you're not where you're supposed to be with God. Amen. Amen. And when Eli was walking with God and he had his house in order, the Philistines, every time they rose up against Israel, they were defeated. And it got so that they had even stopped attacking. But ladies and gentlemen, how many of you know the devil knows when you're not where you're supposed to be with God? The devil knew. And so the devil, he talked to his people, the Philistines, and told them, rise up. And when they rose up, Israel got in his formation. And in his formation that they got in combat, they did not have the archers first. They did not have the skilled swordsmen first. No. They had the Ark of the Covenant. And they had the priesthood tribe. And they would lead their army into battle. And oh, ladies and gentlemen, they looked good. You couldn't tell. You couldn't tell anything was wrong. Amen. They were in the same formation, same garment. The same formation where they had defeated the Philistines time after time after time after time. Amen. But this time, amen, the Philistines who worked for the devil knew that Israel wasn't right. Amen. And as they walked up toward him, amen, and the battle started, ladies and gentlemen, they defeated the armies of Israel. And they took the Ark of the Covenant. A sad day when they took the Ark of the Covenant. Amen. And when they brought the Ark of the Covenant back, amen, the Philistines was rejoicing. The women were dancing. The children was dancing all around. And then they wanted to show all the Philistines that their God was greater than the God of Israel. And so what they did is they took the Ark of the Covenant and they laid it before their God Dagon. They laid it before Dagon to show that the God of Israel was submissive to their God. And they shouted and they danced and they got drunk and did all kind of stuff. Amen. But when the party was over, good God Almighty, and they came back the next morning, and when they walked in, and when they got to the area where that huge God Dagon was, amen, when they looked, God had taken Dagon and put it face down in front of the Ark of the Covenant. Can you imagine, ladies and gentlemen, if somebody took the Ark of the Covenant and put it in front of the Statue of Liberty, And then you go there the next morning, and the Statue of Liberty is laying prostrate in front of the Ark of the Covenant. Oh, when they saw those people, they were so entrenched into their false god. They were so entrenched to their nationalism that they did not, amen, properly recognize the miracle that they had just saw. They did not want to hear God, because in their mind, their hearts were hard. That means their mind was not open. And so what they did is they got thousands of men and they pulled old Dagon back up. I don't know about you, but I don't want to serve a God that I got to pull him up. I need a God that's going to be able to pull me up. Amen. What kind of God is laying on his face and can't get up? Oh, I remember that commercial. Amen. It had these old people and they said, I've fallen and I can't get up. And they had to call somebody. Amen. 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 What kind of God can even stand up? But the people of Palestine, the Philistines, amen, they would rather go with their false god than go with the true God. And they propped Dagon up. But oh, I tell you what, that was not the end of the story. Because they propped him up, and then the next time they came, amen, the next time they came, Dagon was falling upon his face to the ground before the ark. And the head of Dagon and both of his hands, God cut him off, and only a stump was left. Only the stump of Dagon that was left. Amen. If he didn't have any, if his head was cut off, then he couldn't see anybody. Because how many of you know that your eyes are in your head? Amen. If the head was cut off, he couldn't hear anybody. Because the ears are attached to your head. Amen. If his head was cut off, he couldn't think because the brain is in the head. Oh my God. Amen. If his hands and arms was cut off, how do you know he couldn't pull you up because his hands was cut off? Amen. He couldn't put his arm around you because his arms was cut off. If his feet was cut off, how many know he couldn't go nowhere? Amen. If his legs was cut off, he couldn't walk. Amen. But his legs and his arms and his head was cut off, and all was left was a stump. Amen. But those people, they were so entrenched into their false doctrine that they would not recognize, still wouldn't recognize God. Amen. And the Bible said that they made themselves content with a stump. They made themselves content with a God that couldn't do anything for them. Amen. They made themselves content with a God who couldn't see nothing. They made themselves content with a God who couldn't hear nothing. They made themselves content with a God who couldn't go in front of them and fight for them. They made themselves, amen, content with a stump. Oh, and God, he was so angered. Amen. He was so angered that he said, you know what? I'm not going to even kill these people. What I'm going to do is I'm going to strike them with hemorrhoids. I don't know about you. I never had hemorrhoids, but I know people that had it. Amen. It's when the lower part of your intestines come out your rectum. Amen. And you can barely walk. And God struck the men of the Philistines with hemorrhoids. Oh, how embarrassing it is to have hemorrhoids, walking around, can't sit down. Amen. Walking around, can't run. Walking around, barely walking. Walking around in misery. Amen. Everywhere you go, people are asking what's wrong with you. And you're too embarrassed to let them know that your hemorrhoids is hanging out. God struck those men
with hemorrhoids. But through all of that, they still never let go of their stump. And I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, this is applicable to us today. Many of us is holding on to stumps. Some of you women, all you got in your house is a stump. He won't work, good God Almighty. He won't clean, good God Almighty. He won't fix nothing, amen. He's sitting there waiting for you to come home to bring your check, amen. But I'm telling you, God is saying, get rid of that stump, amen. Some of you hooked up with these drug dealers and you got kids up in the house, amen. You ain't got nothing but a stump. And that stump could get you killed. Amen. These people come in there and break in your house and start shooting up. Amen. Let me tell you something, baby. You don't need somebody that's selling drugs. Amen. God will provide. Get out there. Get you a job. Amen. And see, God might have a good man for you. But as long as you're holding on to the stump, you'll never get hold to a good man. Amen. God is trying to bless somebody, but they're holding on to a stump. Somebody here, brother, you got a woman, amen, that all she do is complain. All she do is flirt with your friends. All she do is sit up there and drink beer. She don't want to work. She don't want to clean the house. She don't want to do nothing. Amen, but you're holding on to it. But you better let that stump go. Some of you, you got a false religion. A religion that's not backed up by the Bible. You got hold to a stump. But I'm telling you, if you learn how to let go of them stumps, God will send you a God that can bring you out. God can send you a God that will give you a word. God can send you a God that can make a way out of no way. God will send you a God that in the middle of the night, when you're so distraught, so distressed, he'll come down and whisper in your ear and tell you everything. It's going to be all right. Amen. But God is not going to contend with a stump. Somebody, I just got an Instagram from heaven. Somebody watching this broadcast, amen, is sleeping with your pastor. And you know who the pastor wife is. But I'm telling you, he ain't nothing but a stump. Get up out of there. Go somewhere where the man of God is going to look after your soul and not fleece the sheep. Amen. I thank God for the late Bishop Bonner. Amen. I remember a friend of mine, he had me go up to his church. And we were sitting up in the church, and we thought it was going to be just a regular service. Amen. But when we got in there, he looked at me, he said, something ain't right. Nobody was singing. Nobody was testifying. And when we were sitting up there, and we saw people whispering, we didn't know what's going on. But then Bishop Bonner got up there and he said, every woman that slept with this pastor, I want you to come down to the altar right now. And nobody moved. And then Bishop said, I see caskets. I see the hearse rolling. Oh, and he starts speaking as God was speaking to him. Amen. About 10 or 11 women came down there. And then he looked at this pastor and he set that pastor down. Amen. Where are the men of integrity that can sit up there, that live in holy and when sin is committed? Amen. Since they are not committing sin, they will confront it and cast it out of the church. Amen. But the reason that's not done, because a lot of them are doing the same thing. Amen. And he rebuked that pastor. Amen. He fired that pastor. And he came back and preached that next Sunday until they got somebody else in here. Amen. It's getting so now. You can't tell the holiness churches from any other church. Amen. Amen. The holiest preachers and doing the same thing some of these secular preachers did. But I'm here to tell you that God is not going to put up with it. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, stop looking for a stump to save you. Get somewhere where you got a true man or woman of God that's looking out for your soul, that's not trying to fleece you, that don't want you just because of your tithe, but is concerned for your soul. I thank God that I got a God that can do what no other God can do. Yeah, I thank God that I don't have to fleece nobody. But my Father in heaven, he's rich in houses of land. And whatever I need, God got it. Can I hear it? God got it. All you Christians that's supporting this president, I just got finished watching him last night. The man sat there and he just lied, talked all over the guy. No manners, no kind of courtesy. And Christians are holding on to this guy just because of a Supreme Court appointment. You made yourself. You made yourself content with a stump. But God is getting tired of Christian folks latching on to stumps. Almost said his name. Latching on to stumps. Amen. Just so you can get some notoriety. Just because they call your name. Just because they let you know that you're one of theirs. You hold on to them. You give yourself up. You let down on your standards. But I'm telling you, God said, I'm tired of these preachers latching themselves onto a stump. Get rid of stumpism. Get rid of stumpism. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ and his righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All underground. Trumpism is sinking sand. Bidenism is sinking sand. Barack Obamaism is sinking sand. The only thing that's solid ground is the name Jesus. What's his name? Oh, it's Jesus. Oh, lift your hands up. Lift your hands up today. Amen. Amen. I'm through. Let's not be like the Philistines who made themselves content with a stump. No head, hands gone. He was like a fish with legs. The fins and the legs was gone. All was left was a headless, armless, legless, finless stump. And they said, I'd rather take this stump than the Ark of Covenant. And because of their hard hearts, God struck those men with hemorrhoids. Oh, it is an embarrassing thing when you have hemorrhoids. And it was an acute case of hemorrhoids. Those men, the Bible said that he touched their secret parts with hemorrhoids. Amen. Walking around, can't sit down. Walking around, can't even lay down. Amen. He had to lay on his stomach. There is a penalty. There are repercussions for settling for a stump. Ladies and gentlemen, you need to make an assessment, young ladies. that young man that you're with, you got to see, does he really care for you? Or is he just with you because you're taking care of him? Brothers, the same thing. Is that sister with you just because you're paying her bills? Or is this somebody that we can make a life together, do some great things together? Ladies, why are you making yourself content, all hung up with this stuff? A good man come right by, but because you got this stump, you're gonna miss him and somebody else gonna get him. I'm gonna say this today, I'm gonna say that. I remember this young lady in my work in DC. Very, very good at what she did. And she came to me and she said, "Pastor Wright, can I take you to God, John? I need to talk to you." And I said, "Sure." And so we go to lunch and she tells me, she said, "Pastor, I don't know." She said, "I go to church and I do what I'm supposed to do. I pay my tithes, but it just seemed like I'm not going to ever get a husband. I'm already 40 years old. I turned 40 years old 3 months ago. And so I asked her, "Well, what do you do?" I said, typical thing, what do you do? She said, "Well, I get up in the morning, get myself ready, I go to work. And then after I go to work, I come home." And I said, "All right, what do you do on the weekend?" And she said, "Well, I wash my clothes, and, you know, get ready for the week." I said, "Okay. If you could pick the activities of a perfect date, what would you do?" And she said, "Well, I go to a nice restaurant." And she told me what she'd order. And then after that, she said, I love plays. And I would go to the plays and I would go to the symphony when it plays. I would go to that. And then I'd come on home." I said, "Well, why don't you do that?" She said, "Well, I don't want to go there by myself." And then I told her this: you can't be happy with someone until you learn how to be happy by yourself. I said, "Just do it." I said, "I come from an old school holiness church. And they used to have a song. They said, 'I found out if you make one step, God will make two.' I said, 'What you haven't done is made that step.'" So what she did is on Fridays, she would go to this nice restaurant. And then she would go to a movie. And then Saturday she would go to the opera. Amen. And after that she would go to the top of the tower and get a little late night snack and then go on back home. She did this for about 3 months. In fact, she told me, she said, "You know what?" And she said, "Dr. Wright, thank you so much, you know, for indulging me in my self-pity." And she said, "But I'm really enjoying myself. I'm enjoying myself." And one evening, after she went to her movie, went to her symphony, and she was sitting at the top of the tower, and all of a sudden her waiter came to her and gave her this note. He said, ma'am, he said, this gentleman over there sent this note down. He said, I don't want to mess my tip up. Do you want to read the note? And she picked the note up and she read it. And he said, I've been coming here for about 3 years. And I just noticed that for the past few months, I've been seeing you. Are you new to the area? I would like to meet you. And when she looked over there, there was this handsome gentleman. And so she told him, come on. And he came over there and they began to talk. And he said, I seen you at the opera. And I seen you at the symphonies. And she said, I never seen you. And he said, oh, but I seen you. And to make a long story short, they've been married 10 years now. Now, what if she had kept staying home feeling sorry for herself? See, sometimes you gotta provoke a miracle. Instead of sitting there waiting for it to drop in your lap, get up there and do something. Amen. What she did, she provoked the miracle. She provoked that husband. Amen. She got up and by faith, she went out and learned how to enjoy herself. She had to find out how to make herself happy. Women, can't no man make you happy. You better learn how to make yourself happy. Brothers, can't no woman make you happy. You better learn how to make yourself happy. Amen. Brothers and sisters, can't no job make you happy. Amen. You better learn how to make yourself happy. The Bible says, as a man thinketh, so is he. Stop settling for stumps. The devil is a liar. You don't have to be by yourself. God got somebody for you. Amen. You just got to get up and go get it. And I ain't talking about running after no man. Go out there and say, you know what? If I had a man, what would we be doing? Amen. What kind of activities would we be doing? And go out there and do it and enjoy yourself. Stop settling for stumps. Stop settling for stumps in your life. Young lady came to me about 18 years ago. And this girl, she was an excellent programmer. Any kind of bugs, any kind of problems, they came to her and she would fix it. And the very people that she was fixing their programs with, they got promoted over her. She came to me, and she got tired of it. And she said, what should I do? I said, leave. Put your resume out there. See what's out there. They had her as a 9. And every 11 position come up, they wouldn't even promote her, wouldn't even look at her. And she put in for the 11th position and they picked her up right away. Lo and behold, this girl's a 15 now. She could be an SES if she wanted to. Amen, but she doesn't want to fool with the responsibility. She actually likes the program. This girl was so good and they appreciated her so much that they made her a technical 15. She wasn't even a supervisor. And lo and behold, the very place that she left, things got so bad they sent her there to fix it. And now the person who wouldn't promote her, she outranks her. Bible said, don't cast your pearls to the swine. Amen. You date somebody and they don't appreciate you? Amen. Tell them what's going on. If they don't get it straight, go leave them alone. I love my wife dearly, but if my wife tell me she leave me, I ain't gonna kill myself. Amen. I love myself too much. I found out, I asked her, what can I do? Amen. To straighten things out. And if she tell me nothing, I'm just sick of you. Hey, I'm sorry, whatever I did. But God knows I ain't going up there and jump on top of my house and jump and kill myself. No, sir. And she's definitely not going to do that if I leave her. Don't make yourself comfortable. Don't settle for a stump. God wants us to have that abundant life. The Bible said, if you seek, ye shall find. Let's look toward heaven. God, I thank you for the word. God, somebody out there is going to catch hold of faith. They're going to do a reassessment of their life. They're going to do a reboot in their life. And God, I thank you for it. That your spirit will go with them. And when they let go of the stump, God, I'm asking you to bless them. That all the dreams and the dreams you've given them, that they will come into fruition. And God, we're claiming it done right now. Bless these thy people. Everybody under the sound of my voice, everybody watching this broadcast, God bless them. Bless this country, God. Heal those. Heal the land. We need this pandemic gone. And God, heal the wickedness and the sin that caused this plague to come upon this country. And God, we rebuke it right now. Get it out the way. So that we can be made whole. In Jesus' name, let us all say amen and amen.